Right.
I'd like to give a warm welcome to you all today, and you notice that I'm back for your second visit in the welcome again, Harry.
Thank you.
Also, there are some other visitors that we have here from Blackburn and then brought a friend along too. So,
is Fiona?
Fiona, is it? Very good. We give a warm welcome to you all, and we trust that you'll have a blessed time with us. Also, notice Chai there is back with us again, and Barbara over there. So, welcome to you all. Just take notice of the following. You remember on Christmas Day when we had a Christmas flower field, and the generous offering was $450, which has been forwarded to the Whitehorse Church's care situation. And during the week, we got a lovely letter back from them, and also the receipt for that amount of money. So, well done. Also remind you that the sweet hour of prayer, which has normally been on Wednesdays, will resume on Wednesday week, which will be the 3rd of February, and it should be in the notices as well. And also next Sunday, our services will be at 11 a.m. again, and Graham will continue his current series that he's commencing today. So thank you.
Thank you, Keith. I'd also just like to add that for anybody who's viewing online, that if there are problems with the live stream this morning, we'd like you to bear with us. Currently, we're limited by the capacity of my iPhone, and the reception on this side of the hill is not good, and having a metal roof is not good. So please bear with us. We anticipate that the bandwidth difficulties will be overcome in the next couple of weeks as we have a Wi-Fi network installed. We've approached TPG about this, and we hope to be able to stream better in the future. Well, having said that, shall we unite our hearts in prayer? Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, Creator and Redeemer, we come to you, our Heavenly Father, as children seeking your presence and your guidance. We come to you, Lord Jesus, the lover of our souls. Revive in us a love for you once again. Holy Spirit, come to us, we pray. Make us in the likeness of our Savior. Energize us to do his will and purpose, and use this hour together to that end. So we will give you the honor and the glory, now and always. Amen.
Well, thank you, Keith. And we're now at the opening hymn, which is Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, which is what we're going to do this morning. The words are on the screen. If you've got the rejoicing book, it's number 523. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Thank you.
Well, good morning from me too. This week we spent a few days with some of our children and grandchildren at the lovely coastal town of Port Fairy, which I hope all of you know. It is something special. Anyway, some of our grandchildren love fishing, others love snorkeling, and at least one of them loves boat. So, snorkeling was what gave me the idea for today's talk. And I went to Wikipedia for a definition of it. So here goes. Snorkeling is the practice of swimming on or through a body of water, highly equipped with a diving mask, a shaped breathing tube called a snorkel, and usually flippers. Well, I have to say, on a few occasions when I have snorkeled, I have not worn flippers, but never mind. In cooler waters, a wetsuit may also be worn. And I think all of our grandchildren did wear wetsuits at Port Fairy. Use of this equipment allows the snorkeler to observe underwater attractions for extended periods with relatively little effort, and also to breathe while face down at the surface. Okay, so in case you didn't know, that's the Wikipedia definition of snorkeling. They also say it's a popular recreation activity, particularly at tropical resort locations. And I think the only time I've really done it with any seriousness was many years ago when we had a holiday on Great Keppel Island. It does provide the opportunity to observe underwater life in a natural setting without all the equipment needed for scuba diving. And it appeals to all ages. I like this bit. It appeals to all ages because of how little effort is involved. That's probably why I was able to give it a go. Okay, I will, you can find out anything else about snorkeling. This time at Port Fairy, I couldn't do it because I hadn't thought ahead, I hadn't brought any equipment, and by the time the two kids who were with us shared out their combined equipment, even the grandchildren had to wait their turn. So I just could sort of float on the surface, swim a bit and look down and appreciate how clear the water was, but I thought, I wish I had brought equipment. Now the week before we had our break, one of Graham's brothers, Jamie, whose wife's family I know Will knew in the past, Jamie came round with his wife, and honestly, I've never seen a 70-year-old so excited about a Christmas present. His daughter had given him a special magnifying glass come microscope. I'm sure there's a proper name for it, but I didn't get around to asking. He was so excited by it. And I find it difficult even to look through binoculars. My eyes just don't like looking through anything other than spectacles. But I did look at this. He came to our house armed with a feather so he could show us how wonderful this was. He also told us that if you get a dead fly, you get a wonderful view. That one, I prefer just to focus on the feather. Often I've been reflecting on what a wonderful gift sight is and how special it is that we with good sight can have our vision enhanced so that we can see the wonders of the created world in even more detail, whether it's under the sea or a dead fly. And Will, as I wrote out this talk, I thought of you because you cope so admirably with your restricted vision. You need a magnifying glass even to be able to read, and yet you never complain and you connect so lovingly with every member of this congregation, and we really thank God for you. So I felt I wanted to acknowledge that. Now, when we talk about about seeing and sight, we don't always mean, you know, I can see you, peek a who, and so on. We often, or sometimes, use it figuratively. I don't know what the proportion is. For example, if we don't understand something and someone, in our case often a grandchild, then explains it again with great patience and very slowly, if we get it, we sometimes say, oh, I see that now, or I can see that. There are many uses in the Bible of the language of sight, and sometimes it is with reference to physical sight. We know that Jesus opened the eyes of someone who was born blind. But way back in the Old Testament, we read about Hagar. She was sent away. She was Abraham's concubine. She bore him a child, Isaac, and Sarah became jealous, because she had at that point no children. And so Hagar and her son were sent away, and Abraham sent them away, equipped with food and water, but they ran out of water. And she thought they would just die. And then we read, God opened her eyes. Hagar saw a well of water, and she went and refilled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. Now, Hagar wasn't blind, but she hadn't seen the well. Now, God intervened either to make her see a well, to enable her to see the well, or by creating a well. We view it as a miraculous happening. And she saw that as God's provision. Now, the Bible also uses the language of sight in the metaphorical, indeed the spiritual sense. In Psalm 119, verse 18, David prays, open my eyes that I may see wonderful things in your law. Or, another translation has it, open my eyes to see the wonderful truths in your instructions. Now, fast forward to Paul before Agrippa, talking about his conversion experience. And you will remember, those of you who know the New Testament, that Paul's conversion experience led to him being blind for some time. Anyway, in front of Agrippa, Paul says that God sent him to preach to the Gentiles, so people who were not Jews, to open their eyes. And we're not talking about physical blindness, we're talking about spiritual blindness. So God sent me to preach to the Gentiles, to open their eyes and turn them from darkness to light. Now, we've talked about how a mask helps you see better, and how Jamie's microscope magnifying glass helps him see better. Similarly, there are various aids to seeing, and if you go to any Christian bookshop, you'll find so many books enable you to see, understand better the wonderful truths in God's instructions. But above all, when we read God's word, or as I know some of you do, listen to it being read, for example, not just in church, I don't mean, but there is David Suchet, the famous actor of Poirot, has recorded the whole Bible, and I know some people in the congregation listen to him. We do on occasion. Brilliant reading. Whatever, whether we're reading it silently or listening to it being read, let's pray for God's Spirit to open our spiritual eyes to what he wants us to learn. And for those of you who love the beach, may you have a lot more happy and safe snorkeling. God bless us all.
Thanks, Christine. I have to get you a small book. Moray is going to bring us our Bible reading this morning. Thank you, Moray.
Is it John 13 or John 3?
It's John 13.
It is 13, is it?
Yes.
Right.
I think that's the one. possibly pick this up. I could never have been an accountant.
So, John chapter 13, verses 31 to 38. In relation to Judas, when he was gone, Jesus said, "Now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself, and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now. Where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. All men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." Simon Peter asked him, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus replied, "Where I am going, you cannot follow now, but you will follow later." Peter asked, "Lord, why can't I follow you now? I will lay down my life for you." And Jesus answered, "Will you really lay down your life for me? I tell you the truth, before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times.
Thank you, Maura, for giving us understanding. May you open our eyes and see wonderful things out of this word. You may be waiting on for your freedom. Heavenly Father, we bring our gifts as a token of our love. We pray that you will lead us into a deeper understanding of what that might mean to love you and to love one another this morning. We ask it for Jesus' sake. Amen. The hymn is number 424, "O Love That Would Not Let Me Go." George Matheson's great hymn. If you don't know George Matheson's story, you should look it up.
I rest my weary soul.
But if by any chance it stops or goes in warrior, Nina and Barry, you're in the land.
Yeah, I can feel it nice.
For anybody viewing, it's quite a warm day now. And it's going to be warmer tomorrow. Well, today Keith has referred to me starting a new series of sermons, and one casts around at the start of the year and thinks, where would the Lord take us this year? And there's a series of sermons that I've often wondered about initiating, and I'm beginning, I think it might run through Easter. I want to take the phrase one another from the New Testament. It's two words in English, of course, one another. And this is the one that I've chosen to begin with, love one another. The phrase, in fact, one another in the New Testament is, well, two words in English, it's one word in Greek, ἀλλήλων is the suggested pronunciation. And it's used 100 times in 94 verses of the New Testament. One another, love one another. I thought we should begin with the passage which Morag read to us from John 13, but I'm going to refer to John 3, and that's the one that was in my head, and probably that's why I printed John 3 here. Thank you for that, picking up on that, Alistair. The last night that Jesus was with his disciples, in John 13 and again in John 14, he told them to love one another. So the 100 verses which refer to the one another, ἀλλήλων, these are mostly connected with the church, what the church should be like. And it gives some clues or some guidelines on how we should measure up as a Christian church. So beginning with Jesus, and that fits in very well with Paul. Paul is in fact responsible for 60% of these 100 verses. And he's writing to churches, and he's reminding them of their obligations to one another. And so this morning, as we look at one another, we're picking up on the idea that Paul had as well in chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians. It talks a great chapter about love. We've got a couple of weddings, actually three weddings lined up this year, and I'm sure that the bride and groom will almost invariably gravitate to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, a chapter about love. And if you read on into chapter 14, you'll find the Apostle then says, according to the New English version, New English Bible, put love first. And so in our series this morning, I'm putting love first. My oldest son has this image on his kitchen wall. It's a big poster, and it depicts Albert Einstein. It's actually a piece of graffiti in New York, which shows Albert Einstein spread over two floors of a building. And from the upper railway line, you can see him holding this poster. Love is the answer. And you might ask yourself, Albert Einstein gets attributed with a lot of things he never said. Did he actually say this? And almost certainly he never said this. But the point is, you don't need to be Albert Einstein to know that love is critically important in our lives. Love matters. But is it true that the world's problems, and our own problems perhaps, have a simple solution? What problems? Well, I'm saying small interpersonal issues, tension between friends, to great global problems. And I've been reading a bit more over the summer, and I've been being reminded of some of those problems. And one of them I'll refer to a little later on in a bit more detail. Is love simply the answer? Domestic violence, slavery, cruelty, injustice, racial prejudice, pollution, war, greed, just start with those. If love is the answer, and it's that simple, why do these problems keep rolling on generation after generation? The human condition is a challenge to us. We're being told here by Jesus to love one another, and I'm using this version of the text on our leaflet and as an icon today to see us through this. If love is the answer, what was the question? Secondly, I want to think about love misunderstood or understood. I want to take up the idea that loving is about giving. And then finally, I want to suggest that we should love for Christ's pick up on these ideas. If love is the answer, what was the question? Well, our human condition is such that life is so complex. Many years ago, there was a vintage Looney cartoon that I liked from, I think I used it in the 1980s. It's a little character on a hilltop looking down at human society. That could be Melbourne, it could be anywhere. And he's looking through not a little microscope like my brother had with 60 to 120 times magnification. Not a mask and snorkel like Christine was suggesting to see the ocean floor beneath us, but he's looking through an understandoscope. That's what we need. We need an understandoscope. That's when we will see clearly what's going on. Well, the human condition is a challenge to us. And the joys and sorrows that we inflict on one another come from our human condition. And the Bible has a diagnosis of that human condition. And I want to suggest two things. Firstly, is it possible that we've misunderstood what we're being asked to do when we're told to love one another? Or is it just that we haven't implemented it for some reason or another? So I want to delve a little deeper, and I want to explore in this series, because most of the one another commands tease out in different ways what it actually means to love one another. So love misunderstood. Let's pick up on this then. Normally we leave it to the poets to tell us about love. And I've picked up a few sonnets over the years because sometimes people want those read at weddings. My favourite is Shakespeare's 116th sonnet. I'm sure you remember it well. Let me not to the marriage of true minds admit impediment. Love is not love which alters when an alteration finds nor bends with the remover to remove. Oh no. It is a never fixed mark which looks on tempests and is not shaken. It is the star of every wandering bark whose worth's unknown or looks better. Love's not time's rule, though rosy lips and cheeks within its bending sickle's compass come. Forget the last couple of lines. You have to look on or Elizabeth Barrett Browning, E.M.E. Browning, you might remember the one that begins, it's a 43rd song. How do I love thee? Let me count the words. And it's a lovely, lovely song. I'm more familiar with Burns. My love was like a red, red. And so we leave it to the poets, but the poets can leave us shortchanged sometimes. Love has a range of meanings. Christine's already referred to Wikipedia, let me refer to it as well. This is the beginning of a 7,000 word explanation of love in Wikipedia. 7,000 words. Love encompasses a range of strong, positive, emotional and mental states, from the most sublime virtue or good habit, the deepest interpersonal affection to the simplest pleasure. An example of this range of meanings is that the love of a mother differs from the love of a spouse, which differs from the love for food. Most commonly, love refers to a feeling of strong attraction and emotional attachment. Well, is it really like this? How do we work out that one love is against another if it's like this? One of the challenges is which love should get priority. For example, it's pretty clear that the love of a parent matters more than the love of a hamburger. I'm sure we could probably agree on this. But some loves are more complex. For example, a grandchild saying to us on holiday, as one did, I think it was addressed to you, Christine, "Grandma, which of your grandchildren do you love the most?" That's a hard question. And what's an honest answer? And how do you give expression to the right answer if it's different from an honest answer? Or we might want to ask fear of missing out, FOMO, you know. How much of our life is, you know, we don't want to miss out on this and we don't want to miss out on that, and so we indulge ourselves, and in other words, we feed our feelings. Is it true that love is primarily an emotional and mental state? Is it primarily about feelings? How do I rate my feeling for a refugee, somebody who's sought to come to Australia and who's been incarcerated for 10 years. How do I feel about that person? Especially after I just read Luke's Gospel, chapter 10, where Jesus talks about the Samaritan. I've been challenged this week, and this is the particular global case that I've been shocked about. I was reading in the Barnabas Fund in connection with the conflict in Nagorno-Karabakh and Azerbaijan. My reading of the Armenian genocide in 1915. It took place in Turkey, and it was an event in which 1.5 million people perished. We know it was a genocide because if people converted, then they were spared. But 1.5 million did not convert to Islam and were killed. At one point, a particular named general tied 2,000 orphans together and had them thrown in a river. I was just shocked by the detail that was there. But it was known to be happening by Western governments, and Western governments did nothing because it was more important at that time to have Turkey as a friend than as an enemy. Christians in the West did nothing to help persecuted Christian fellow Christians. And so we ask ourselves, why has our government not recognized this? Why have many governments around the world not recognized this genocide? It seems we still want to maintain a kind of slightly hazy recognition of the past in Turkey. Do we really believe what love is? Is it about our feelings? Do we reduce it just to how we feel about the situation, or is it more? I want to suggest to you that as we seek to prioritize what love is, we need to have a clear idea of where it begins. And I want to suggest to you that Jesus is very clear about this. When he was asked what the great commandment was, he put God at the top. Love for God. So we have to begin with the place of God in our lives. And so I want to ask this question. Have we been faking love? The question is, what is love in our lives? The way in which we feel about something is not necessarily a good indicator of our love. I think we get a good idea about this when we talk about falling in love. What does Jesus say? He doesn't say, "My dear friends, I want you to fall in love with each other." He says, "I command, this is my commandment." Now, mostly when we think about love, we think about it in the sense of falling in love. As if we were passive, we can't help it. It's about our feelings, how I react in the presence of. This burger, better than that burger. Right? This music, over that music. This friend, over that friend. So, I'm rating my feelings. But that's not what Jesus is saying. And how do we know this? Well, Jesus talks not about falling in love, but loving others. And John, who's writing this in chapter 13 and explaining this last night that Jesus was with his disciples and the priorities that he lays before them, he has it right close to the beginning of his gospel, what has been regarded as the Bible in miniature, that beautiful verse in John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave. And I'm suggesting to you and to my own heart as well that we need to evaluate our loving by our attitude, our giving capacity to others. I'm not talking just about money. Money is merely one indicator. But I'm talking about our time, our attendance, our concern, our desire, our mentoring, all of those things where we give of ourselves for others. The very idea that love can be commanded suggests to us a different idea of love from what we expect. And as Jesus approaches the hour, he stresses this more and more. The hour of his self-giving is near. He knows that the disciples won't find the strength to do this themselves. He says, then in the very next chapter he says, there will be the Holy Spirit to do it. It's not something that we dredge up from within ourselves. It's something we come to God and ask for. We need the strength of the Spirit. We need, as we sang at the beginning, open yourself to the Spirit. Be aware that God is looking for something in us that we can't put there, but that he gives us. And he has revealed it to us in the person of Jesus. The temptation, of course, is to prioritize our own interests. And this is difficult not to do that. But it was difficult for the first disciples. How did the reading end? Peter, before the rooster crows three times, you will deny. We might look around the world and we see the seeds of the problem, not just in faraway places like Turkey and their problem with the Armenian people. So the Jewish people knew that they had to love God, and they knew that they had to love their neighbor as themselves. Remember the Apostle Paul in Acts, a beautiful verse in Acts 20:35. You won't find it in the Gospels, but Paul reminds us there the words of the Lord Jesus, which reminds us that of all the things that Jesus said and did, they were not all written down by John or by the other apostles. But here is Paul reminding us of something. Jesus said that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Do we really believe that? Jesus quoted the Old Testament, and we need to be captivated by that sort of priority and by Christ's love. We must love one another. This is our response to his love for us. In his first letter, in chapter 4, verse 19, John says, we love him because he first loved us. Didn't begin with us at all. Began with him. And this is echoed by Paul, who says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, pursue what is good for one another and for everyone else. So let's think about love for Christ's sake. I think one of our fears is that there's so much to experience and we cannot experience it all. The story is told of a very wealthy Sydney, and I hope I'm telling you Sydney, I found some, don't know, I was told that it was a true story. But it could be perhaps something you might hear in any city. The story is told of a very wealthy Sydney man who died. His funeral took place in St. Peter's Cathedral. And while they're waiting for the service to begin, a mourner at the front turned to somebody in the pew behind him and said, in more than a stage whisper, how much do you leave? And the person in the seat behind said, all of it. All of it. You can't take it with you. Do we strive for the things we can't take with us? Is that what we're setting our affections on? Are we loving those things? Or are we sort of adjusting our priorities to love what God loves? God loves people. He works to redeem people. He wants his message of Jesus to reach into human hearts and turn them into lovers, because God himself is a lover and has reached to us. Tim Keller puts it beautifully in this quotation. The gospel is this, he says. We are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe. Yet at the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we ever dared believe. More loved and accepted than we ever dared believe. Dear friends, we've been loved beyond comprehension and beyond computation. Is it any wonder that the psalmist, envisaging the great king that would come, says in Psalm 72, his name forever shall endure. Last like the sun it shall. Men shall be blessed in him, and blessed all nations shall be called. Do you want to be clinging on to things that you cannot hold on to when the gospel offers you something that will never perish? Jesus himself said, my words will not pass away, So let us ask the Holy Spirit to renew our love to Christ and grant us the courage to express it in our relationships with one another and not renege on our commitment to follow Jesus and his command to love one another. This is the Christian response. He loved us before we loved him. While we were, the Apostle Paul says, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And so we come. Love, alleluia. Love one another for Christ's sake. This, I was feeling so powerless talking about love. Because the talk is cheap. You and I, we have to live. We have to be different people as we step into this world and as we move into the rest of 2021. We have to be the people God is calling us to be. We have to live in response to his love toward us. That has to shape us and make us Christ-like. Christ disciples, little presence of Jesus. Christ playing in 10,000 voices. May that be true. May we bring his light into our own lives and share it with our neighbors. Amen. I'm going to lead a prayer now. I'm not going to put the prayer on the screen, but I'll lead you through it and invite you to join in the Lord's Prayer at the close. Shall we pray? Herein, O Lord, is love. Not that we loved you, but that you loved us and sent your Son to be the means by which our sins have been forgiven. Lord Jesus, forgive us anew for the ways in which we seek to increase our own wealth, power, and influence. Teach us how to love and to give as you have loved us. Holy Spirit, strengthen us to place our steps in the path of the Savior and sensitize us that we may learn to love one another. May the love of Christ our Savior fill our lives from day to day. We so easily lose sight of love in a world in turmoil. Love can be so debased and yet sometimes so inspiring. This Australia Day weekend, we thank you for the many around our nation whose lives bear testimony to service beyond the call of duty. We have been very conscious of the workers on the front line of the COVID pandemic, medicos, nurses, police, and ADF personnel. We thank you for them and for the risks they take to care for those who are infected and to manage the regulations that protect the community. We're glad to hear that in some of the worst affected places, vaccinations have begun, and we pray that the rollout will be increasingly well managed. And now that the USA is back with the World Health Organization, the global needs may be more effectively addressed, we do pray. We ask that the vaccine rollout in Australia will soon begin and provide an added layer of protection for those most at risk. Help us to play our part in assisting neighboring countries in our Pacific Rim. Comfort those who mourn as a result of the recent drownings. Remember the dangers of our shores and waterways and the fire risks in the bush. We pray for the women and the men who work as lifesavers and firefighters. May they be kept in safety, even as they seek to secure the safety of others. We give thanks that the inauguration of President Joe Biden in the USA has taken place without disruption. As he pursues his electoral agenda, we pray that there will be humility in the nation and the healing of the divisions. We have borne hope each day the terrible inhumanity of our species, our abuse of the environment, our damage to the animals with whom we share the planet, and our humanity to each other. We are aware that the rise of the pandemic has been used in many places as a cover for increasing intolerance with minorities. And especially that there has been a rise of hostility towards Christians pray for that great nation, that the hearts of its leaders will be changed, and that the persecution of Christian, Uyghur, and Tibetan people will cease, and that there will emerge a new tolerance of Hong Kong and Taiwan. We ask you to strengthen the messengers of the cross. Keep them true to you, Lord Jesus. Give them the grace they need to bear witness, whatever their circumstances this day. These things we ask in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray together and say, Our Father, in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Closing hymn.
And of those whom we love, now and always.